नास्तिक दैट इज नॉन बिलीवर इन ऑल द करंट सेंसेस ऑफ द टर्म. इट डिड नॉट बिलीव इन द ऑथेंटिसिटी ऑफ वेदास, इट डिड नॉट बिलीव इन द एग्जिस्टेंस ऑफ गॉड, इट डिड नॉट बिलीव इन द डॉक्ट्रिन ऑफ कर्म, लाइफ आफ्टर डेथ और अदर वर्ल्ड्स. फॉर दिस रीजन ए चार्वाक फिलोसोफर वॉज कॉल्ड नास्तिक पार एक्सलेंस, नास्तिक शिरोमणि. बट दिस डिड नॉट मीन दैट चार्वाक वॉज ए निहिलिस्ट, एन एब्सोल्यूट नॉन बिलीवर. Because he did accept the possibility of happy life in this world, a secular, this worldly way of life. This character of the Charvaka school is reflected in its traditional nomenclature, Lokayata. In the compound word Lokayata, there are two words, Loka and Ayata. The word Loka here means world, rather this world. The meaning of the word ayata, relevant in this context, is restrained or controlled. The word lokayata now means restrained by this world. This can be interpreted as limited by the belief that this is the only world, or limited by this worldly approach. This etymological interpretation clearly reflects the focus of the Charvaka on this world and disregard for belief in other worlds. Another important identification of Charvaka school is that it is a reason-centric inquiry. The word used for such an inquiry in ancient Indian literature was anvikshiki. The word anvikshiki is derived from anu plus iksha, which means cognition which follows perception, that is inferential cognition or the cognition based on reasoning. Anvikshiki in this sense is the inquiry based on reasoning. Kautilya, the political thinker of first century BC, is known to have included Lokayata under Anvikshiki. In his work Arthashastra, he enumerates four faculties of knowledge, four vidyas, which a king should have expertise in. They are religion, economy, polity, and the reason-centric inquiry. That is Trayi, Varta, Dandaniti, and Anvikshiki. Under the reason-centric inquiry, that is Anvikshiki, he mentioned three philosophical schools, namely Sankhya, Yoga, and Lokayata. Anvikshiki, that is reason-centric inquiry, gives us a conception of philosophy which is different from the popular conception of philosophy which is expressed by the term darshana. Indian philosophical systems are popularly called darshana. About every darshana, it can be said that it presents a perspective on reality, life, and knowledge. It has to have some theory of pramanas and some understanding of reality and life, which was supported by the pramana theory. The theory of pramanas accepted by a darshana may be of any kind. It may assign centrality to experience and reason, or to dogmatic adherence to scriptures. In this sense, darshana could be a rational inquiry or a religious inquiry. What Kautilya called anvikshiki, however, was a rational inquiry. It is interesting to see how Sankhya, Yoga, and Lokayata, which Kautilya has called anvikshiki, are reason-centric, that is how they attach importance to reason. Here it should be noted that what Kautilya calls by the term yoga refers to Nyaya Vaisheshika system and not to Patanjali's yoga system. Hence, the three disciplines Kautilya is grouping under the common title Anvikshiki are Sankhya, Nyaya Vaisheshika, and Lokayata. Kautilya brings them to under common title on the basis of their common methodological approach. Kautilya describes Anvikshiki as a faculty of knowledge which examines strengths and weaknesses of other faculties, namely religion, polity, and economy, by applying reasons. Insofar as Anvikshiki emphasizes reason rather than faith, one can say that the common point between the three philosophical systems which come under Anvikshiki must be that they are rational systems. Here we can compare the group of three systems, Sankhya Yoga, that is Nyaya Vaisheshika, and Lokayata, with another group consisting of two systems, namely Purva Mimamsa and Vedanta. The latter group not only emphasizes verbal testimony against inference, but it claims itself to be rooted in verbal testimony, that is, Vedic scriptures. The former group, on the other hand, emphasizes inference after perception and gives somewhat subordinate status to scriptural authority. At least the systems in this group do not claim themselves to be solely dependent on scriptures. Nyaya Vaisheshika as Anvikshiki. Although the three schools falling under Anvikshiki can be called rational in a broad sense, they vary in the degree of rationality. For example, Vaisheshikas and Sankhyas use both scientific and speculative reasoning. They use the former for establishing worldly phenomena and the latter for establishing transcendental metaphysics. In the later period, we find that Nyaya philosophers identified Anvikshiki with Nyaya, that is, the science of reasoning, but while doing so, they also insisted that reasoning should not go against verbal testimony. Now, Sankhya is Anvikshiki. Sankhya school also attaches great importance to inference as pramana, but the kind of inference it depends upon for establishing its metaphysical claims is analogical or speculative reasoning, which is called samanyato drishta anumana. Moreover, it takes recourse to verbal testimony in the case of subtler objects, which cannot be established even by speculative reasoning. Hence, Sankhya accepted verbal testimony as the last resort. Now, Lokayata as Anvikshiki. Lokayata as a school of philosophy too developed a rational approach. But the unique feature of Lokayata against the other two rational philosophies was that it emphasized reasoning without any regard for the scriptural authority, either Vedic or non-Vedic. It applied reasoning not in accordance with scriptures or in the service of scriptures, but it did it even by challenging scriptures. To disregard scriptures and to disregard otherworldly beliefs such as soul, God, rebirth, and other worlds go hand in hand. Lokayata in this sense could be understood as a rationalist philosophical movement which attempted to solve individual and social issues merely on empirical, rational and practical grounds without taking recourse to religion. Kautilya seems to have respect for such a rationalist philosophy, as a result of which he included it in Anvikshiki. The other schools of philosophy criticized Charvaka as nihilistic, having no concern for values. They believed that morality cannot be justified without accepting transcendent entities such as karmic results, other worlds, soul, or God. Some of them also believed that moral and social values cannot be justified without accepting scriptures, Vedic or non-Vedic, personal, divine, or impersonal. As against this, Charvakas criticize the otherworldly worldview and other schools, view of other schools by applying reason instead of scriptures or verbal testimony. But for this, it would not be correct to infer that all philosophers of Charvaka school must have used a common method of reasoning. We find in the history of Lokayata / Charvaka school of thought that different Charvaka philosophers used reasoning in different ways for countering otherworldly view. This seems to have given rise to different sub-schools of Charvaka / Lokayata school of philosophy. the different sub-schools of the Charvaka Lokayata school that we are going to consider here are the result of epistemological diversity. We do not see an equally great diversity in their ontological or axiological views. It is this epistemological diversity with which we are concerned in today's and it should be next Sunday's talk. This epistemological diversity can be understood in terms of their views concerning pramanas. Now, diverse epistemology of Charvakas. A. Cognitive skepticism, according to which there are no pramanas. Then B. Extreme empiricism, according to which perception is the only pramana. C. What can be called positivist empiricism, according to which perception and empirically testable inference are pramanas. And D. What can be called common sense empiricism, according to which perception and commonsensical inferences are pramanas. Now, we will first deal with cognitive skepticism, according to which there are no pramanas. As we have seen, all the systems except Charvakas believed in otherworldly metaphysics and value system. Since establishment of such metaphysics and value system was the main thing for them, they employed the whole pramana system in the service of them. When the non-Charvaka systems accepted perception as pramana, some of them accepted extraordinary perception or extrasensory and extramental perception along with it, which made room for knowledge of mystical and occult phenomena. When they accepted inference as pramana, they accepted not only this worldly empirical objects to be knowable through inference, but also otherworldly trans-empirical objects. They also accepted verbal testimony as pramana for proving such trans-empirical entities such as heavens and heavenly beings and our obligations towards them. As a result, some Charvakas were critical about the whole pramana system. They questioned the possibility of knowledge through pramanas. This gave rise to the skeptical stance of Charvaka school. Lokayatikas were often called negative debaters, that is, Vaitandika, by their opponents. It was claimed by the opponents that Charvakas took pleasure in refuting others' positions without upholding any position as their own. And though this is not true about Charvakas in general, in the history we do find the philosophers like Jayarashi, who is also called Jayarashi Bhatta, the author of Tattvopaplavasivu, who denied even perception as an authoritative means to knowledge and still declared his legacy to Brihaspati, the so-called founder of the Lokayata system. Now, the second sub-school that we are going to consider is extreme empiricism, according to which perception is the only means to knowledge. There were some Lokayatikas who held that perception is the only means to knowledge. They thought that the main culprit in positing the transcendent entities like soul, God, and other worlds is inference and not perception. We may discard the so-called extraordinary perception, but it is not necessary to discard even sensory perception. Rather, it is necessary to assert it. However, inference as a means to knowledge is not acceptable. The position that only perception is pramana and no other means to knowledge is pramana can be called extreme empiricism. This is the popular version of Charvaka empiricism and is found in the works like Sarvadarshana Sangraha. Third view or third sub-school of Charvakas, which we are going to discuss in detail in the next lecture, is positive empiricism, according to which perception and empirically testable inference are pramana. But there were some charvakas who realized that though inference as a means to knowledge has some intrinsic limitations or defects, at the same time it cannot be denied that inference is a powerful tool of the knowledge of this world and justification of this worldly view of life. So we need not discard all inferences. The kind of inference which is testable by perception can be accepted as a means to knowledge. So we need not discard all inferences. However, the inferences which are not so testable can be discarded. This can be called a positivist form of mitigated empiricism. Jayanta Bhatt, a Nyayalogician, acknowledges this variety of Charvaka empiricism in his work Nyaya Manjari. He calls such Charvakas more learned Charvakas or Sushikshitatara Charvakas. Now, last subschool of Charvaka would be I call it common sense empiricism, according to which perception and commonsensical inference are pramanas. There were also some Charvakas who accepted still wider epistemological framework, which may be called the framework of common sense empiricism. In addition to perception, the inferences which are acceptable within the limits of this world and this life, that is what is called loka prasiddha anumana, are acceptable in this framework. But those who transcend the limits of this world and this life and presuppose other worlds and life after death are not acceptable. This view is attributed to a Charvaka thinker called Purandara by Kamalashila in his Tattva Sangraha Panjika. In today's lecture, I will focus on the first two subschools, namely skepticism and extreme empiricism. And in the next lecture, I will focus on the remaining two subschools. Now, two forms of epistemological skepticism can be located in Charvaka tradition. Jayanta Bhatt, a Nyaya philosopher of 8th century, refers in his work Nyaya Manjari to the view of what he calls Charvaka Dhurta, Nev Charvakas, according to which the number and nature of pramanas cannot be determined. And this indeterminability itself is the determinate truth. According to this view, different pramanas get fused with each other in a piece of knowledge such that we cannot identify any specific pramana of which it is a case. This objection refers to anarchy in the realm of pramanas, but it does not question the very possibility of knowledge. A more radical and systematic version of skepticism is found in the work Tattvopaplavasimha, which can be translated as valorous like a lion in devastating all principles. This is the work of 8th century philosopher called Jayarashi Bhatt. Jayarashi, in the beginning of his work, quotes Lokayata aphorisms which are popularly known as materialist, but interprets them as the expressions of ontological skepticism. Jayarashi's interpretation preserves all the critical destructive aspects of the Lokayata, but at the same time questions the materialist ontology which is popularly attributed to it. So, the negative elements of Jayarashi's interpretation, the negative element which Jayarashi's interpretation shares with Lokayata are denial of God, denial of soul, denial of other worlds, rebirth, ritualism, etc. And the positive views popularly attributed to Lokayata, which are questioned by Jayarashi, are the existence of the four elements, namely earth, water, fire and air, the only pramana, namely perception, The thesis that consciousness arises from the four elements and that body is the self, that is Dehatmavada, Bhuta Chaitanyavada, and Pratyakshaika Pramanavada. These are some of the positive aspects of the popular Lokayata view, but Jayarashi questions all these views. According to Jayarashi's interpretation, the Lokayata philosopher Brihaspati does not intend to assert the existence of the four material elements. He is only reporting what is accepted among the people. So there are aphorisms like Prithivyapas Tejo Vayuriti Tattvani Tat Samudaye Sharira Vishaya Indriya Saudhnya. So there are four Mahabhutas, namely Prithvi, Ap, Tejas and Vayu, and Indriya, Vishaya and Sharira. They are just combinations of these four Mahabhutas. This is one of the Brihaspatya Sutras. And Jayarashi interprets that particular sutra in this way, that here Brihaspati is only reporting the popular view. He does not really mean that this is the acceptable view. What he intends to say, that even the existence of these four principles cannot be established, what to say of others? Jayarashi then presents a formula which initiates his exercise in cognitive skepticism. Now, what is the formula that Jayarashi gives? Jayarashi's formula highlights the logical relation between epistemological skepticism and ontological skepticism. He states, an ontological element is established through a pramana. A pramana is established through its proper definition. So, sallakshan nibandhanam mana vyavasthanam mana nibandhanacha meya sthitihi. Hence, by critically examining different definitions of pramanas, Jayarashi ultimately shows that the ontological element, that is prameyas, cannot be established. So, pramanas cannot be established because no so-called definition of pramana is acceptable, and because pramanas cannot be established, prameyas also cannot be established. The major part of Jayarashi's work consists of his critical examination of definitions of pramanas, or definitions of knowledge in general, offered by different schools of philosophy such as Nyaya, Buddhism, Purva Mimamsa and Jainism. Through criticism of pramanas, Jayarashi questions the possibility of knowledge in general. Jayarashi begins his critical exercise with the Nyaya definition of perception, which runs as follows. Perception is the cognition which is produced by the contact between a sense organ and an object, which is non-verbal, which does not deviate from the object, and which is determinate in nature. Jayarashi critically examines every term in the definition, but his main attack is on the term non-deviant, that is avyabhichari. So, according to Nyaya Sutra of Gautama, perception as pramana has to be avyabhichari, that is, it should not deviate from the real object. And Jayarashi questions this element, this aspect of the definition of perception. Jayarashi considers different possible meanings of the term and criticizes the definition under the corresponding interpretation. If we decide that the perceptual cognition is non-deviant, that is avyabhichari, simply means that the object of the cognition exists, then the question arises, how do you know that the object exists? If the answer is on the basis of the perceptual cognition, then the argument will be circular. That is, the existence of the object is established on the basis of perceptual cognition, and pramanahood of the perceptual cognition is established on the basis of the existence of the object. Now, if one says that the perceptual cognition can be decided to be non-deviant on the basis that it is caused by non-defective sense organs, then according to Jayarashi, the question arises, how is the non-defectiveness of sense organs known? It is of course not known by perception. If it is inferred from the true perception of the object itself, then it is a clear case of circularity. If, on the other hand, the term non-deviant is taken to mean that which gives the volitional success, pravritti samarthana, then apart from other objections, Jayarashi raises a question whether this characteristic of a true cognition is known or not. He asks, if it is unknown, how do you say that it is? And if it is known, then how do you know that this knowledge satisfies the condition of being non-deviant? Similarly, he considers Purvamimamsa definition of pramana, particularly the one prescribed by Bhatta school. It has two major elements. One, pramana is a cognition which is not falsified, not sublated, that is abadhita by other cognitions. And two, it is cognition of the object which is not already cognized, that is agruhita grahi or anadhigatartha gantru. The first element may be called non-falsification element, and the second can be called novelty element. Non-falsification as the defining feature of pramana is questionable, according to Jayarashi, because a cognition does not become true simply because its falsifying cognition by chance does not arise. The possibility of its falsification cannot be ruled out by simple non-occurrence of falsification. With regard to novelty as a defining feature of pramanahood of a cognition, Jayarashi points out that there is no reason why out of two cognitions of a single object arising in sequence, the first should be regarded as authentic because it has novelty, and the second as inauthentic simply because the first occurs first and the second afterwards. The novelty element of Mimamsaka's definition is also an element in Buddhist definition of pramana. But Buddhists, as Jayarashi shows, have to face additional difficulty because of their doctrines of momentariness and that of the radical difference between the objects of perception and inference, that is what is called pramana vyavastha or pramana viplava. Due to these reasons, no two cognitions can have the same object. Hence, the defining feature of pramana, namely that it should cognize a new object, becomes redundant. In any case, because the object is momentary, every cognition will have a new object, so we will not be able to distinguish between pramana type of cognition and apramana type of cognition because both of them have new objects. In this way, by criticizing the conceptions of pramana given by all the major epistemology schools, Jayarashi doubts the possibility of knowledge in general. He raises a basic question about the question of knowledge as true cognition and shows by his critical apparatus that no cognition can be determined to be true. Here it is to be clearly noted that by saying that no cognition can be determined to be true, Jayarashi does not mean that every cognition is necessarily false. As he denies the so-called knowledge, that is true cognition, he also denies illusion. What Jayarashi asserts with this is that no distinction can be made between true and false cognitions. For him, every cognition has some object, which is, according to him, the content of that cognition. But from this, it does not necessarily follow that the object of cognition also exists objectively. Here, when Jayarashi, like many other Indian philosophers, uses the words like avabhasa, vijnana, jnana, buddhi, he only means by them cognition understood in truth value neutral sense. So here jnana does not mean knowledge, but just cognition, which could be true or false. Illusion is not the same as appearance. While one has an illusion, one cognizes something in place of another thing, that is to say, illusion has some existential import, that which appears in the illusion, as well as an existential support, adhishthana, in place of which it appears. That is in Rajju Sarpa illusion, we can say that rope is the adhishthan of the illusion and sarpa is the what appears in the illusion. That is, it is existential import of the illusion. But appearance may not have this duality of something appearing as something else. It may be just an appearance. Thus, while saying that no cognition can be proved to be true, we are not asserting that every cognition is an illusion. We are only saying that it is avabhasa, it is an appearance. We cannot say that it is a true appearance, we cannot say that it must be a false appearance. For Jairashi, any cognition is circumscribed by its object. It cannot encroach upon another cognition which is again circumscribed by its own object. The idea is that one cognition cannot be falsified by another cognition, nor can it be supported by another cognition. This also means that no knowledge claim can establish by itself the existence of anything beyond the level of appearance. I have already made some remarks about Jairashi's skepticism in the second talk when I compared it with Nagarjuna's refutation of all pramanas and also with a similar skeptical argumentation of the Vedantin Sri Harsha. As we saw there, though Nagarjuna and Sri Harsha refute all pramanas, through this refutation itself they try to draw metaphysical conclusions. Nagarjuna, through refutation of pramanas, tries to show the interdependent character of relative, that is non-essentialist, interdependent character or relative, that is non-essentialist character of the so-called knowledge and reality. Sriharsha, through refutation of pramanas, tries to draw our attention to pure consciousness as the ultimate reality, which is beyond the duality of knowledge and the knowable. The other way of distinguishing among the three skeptics is to compare their attitudes to empirical reality and ultimate reality, that is Vyavahara and Paramartha. Nagarjuna and Sriharsha both criticize the empirical reality by refuting all the means and objects of knowledge. At the same time, they have to accept the empirical reality as conventional reality, which is necessary for the possibility of intellectual philosophical exercise leading to the knowledge of ultimate reality, which is the ultimate goal of life according to them. Both of them accept empirical reality as having instrumental value for reaching the ultimate reality, though the nature of ultimate reality is different according to them. According to them means Nagarjuna and Sriharsha. Jairashi differs from both of them in an important way. Jairashi approves of the worldly practices, Vyavahara, but does not try to give any justification of them. According to him, if one reflects upon them philosophically, one does not reach any essence or ultimate truth, tattva. It is therefore advisable, according to him, not to reflect upon them but entertain them at surface level. That is why he describes them as enjoyable insofar as they are not reflected upon, avicharita ramaniya. The skeptical refutation of the empirical reality, which induces Nagarjuna and Sriharsha to transcend the level of empirical reality and embrace the ultimate reality, does not induce Jairashi to do so. Rather, it leads Jairashi to deny ultimate reality, which he terms as tattvas, that is principles. That is why Jairashi entitles his work Tattva Paplava Sivha, which means vigorous like a lion in the act of devastating all tattvas. Now, after Jairashi's cognitive skepticism, we turn to the other subschool, which I call extreme empiricism, according to which perception is the only pramana. The epistemological position popularly attributed to Charvakas can be called extreme empiricism, according to which perception is the only pramana and the inference is not a pramana at all. In the history of Indian philosophy, it is not just Charvakas who deny the pramanahood of inference. Like Charvakas, the philosophers of two other schools criticize inference as pramana. Bhartruhari of grammar school and Shankaracharya of non-dualist Vedanta school. They point out many intrinsic defects in reasoning or inference as a means to knowledge. But there is a difference between the Charvaka approach to inference and that of the other two. When Charvakas criticize inference, they weigh its strength against perception and not against verbal testimony. On the other hand, when Bhartruhari and Shankara criticize inference, they weigh it against verbal testimony, particularly the testimony of Vedas. Bhartruhari and Shankara pointed out the weaknesses of inference as pramana and assigned a limited role to it, namely that of supporting Vedic insights by reasons. Naturally, they expected that an inference is acceptable if it is not contradicted by Vedic authority. According to the view of the Charvaka, on the other hand, no special treatment needs to be given to verbal testimony. Now, three points of clarification insofar as the terminology of is used here, but the term pramana, for example, what is the strong and weak sense of the term pramana. Before we turn to understand the Charvaka criticism of inference as pramana, it is necessary to be clear on some points of terminology. Take for example the term pramana. Here the extreme empiricist Charvakas are using the word pramana in the strong sense of the term. The distinction between strong and weak sense of the term pramana is important in this context. The term pramana in its weak sense means to knowledge or instrument of knowledge. In this sense, we obtain knowledge, that is true cognition, through a pramana, but there is no guarantee that every cognition a pramana gives rise to must be a true cognition. In the weak sense of the term, pramana is not understood as an authoritative means to knowledge. Take for example instrument of perceptual knowledge as Nayayikas understand it. According to them, for example, visual sense organ is pramana because we obtain veridical visual perception with the help of it. But visual sense organ does not always give veridical perception. With the same visual sense organ, we also sometimes have illusory cognition. Hence, we can say that visual sense organ is pramana in weak sense of the term. On the other hand, pramana in the strong sense of the term means an authority. It carries the sense of infallibility, which implies that a pramana cannot go wrong. For example, when Purva Mimamsa philosophers talk about Vedas as pramana, they use the word pramana in the strong sense of the term. They mean thereby that Vedas are infallible. When Charvakas say that inference is not pramana, they use the word pramana in the strong sense. They mean thereby that inferences are not infallible. They probably do not deny that inference can sometimes give us true cognition. For instance, they do not deny that if one sees smoke on the hill and infers that there must be fire, it is quite possible or probable that one will actually find fire if one goes there. What they are denying is that there is a necessity by which one must find the fire there. Second clarification is about the concepts of validity and soundness. Another terminological question about the Charvaka criticism of inference is, what do Charvakas question about inference? Validity of inference or its soundness? Many standard books on Indian philosophy written by well-known writers spread a misunderstanding about Charvakas that when the latter criticize inference as pramana, they question the validity of inference. This misunderstanding is probably the consequence of a more general misunderstanding about the notion of anumana pramana, according to which it is translated as valid inference. As a matter of fact, the Charvaka criticism of anumana questions soundness of inference, not its validity. In fact, it should have been kept in mind, at least when modern logic uses the words valid in a special sense, that the notion of pramana is primarily concerned with truth and not with validity. Here we have to note the distinction between validity and soundness. A valid inference is one, the conclusion of which necessarily follows from its premises, whether the premises are true or false. And a sound inference is the one which is not only valid, but has true and only true premises. As a result, a sound inference is such that it necessarily yields a true cognition. The Charvaka objection against inference as pramana is not primarily about validity of inference, but about the question whether a formally valid inference of a particular kind necessarily yields truth. Even a valid inference may fail to yield a true conclusion if at least one of its premises is false. It is well known that Charvakas raise the question about the truth of one of the premises, namely the statement of universal concomitance, that is the statement of Vyapti. Third clarification, the terms Anumana and inference. It should also be noted that the Charvaka criticism of inference, that is Anumana, as Pramana, should be taken as their criticism of inference, should not be taken as their criticism of inference in general. The translation of the word Anumana as inference is misleading. Anumana is a specific kind of inference. Inference would be inductive or deductive, and the latter two can be of various kinds. For instance, the valid inference in propositional logic and quantification logic differ from each other, and those in the relational logic differ from both, though they overlap with each other to some extent. Anumana of Indian tradition would be close to Barbara of syllogistic logic, that is, in which the premises and conclusion can be reduced to a type of proposition, something like all men are mortal, all Greeks are men, that is, all humans are mortal, all Greeks are human, therefore all Greeks are mortal. So all these propositions are a type of propositions, and this particular form of inference is called Barbara in syllogistic logic. That is B-A-R-B-A-R-A, so A-A-A. Propositions are both premises and the conclusion. In quantification logic, it would be close to the inference, the proof of which involves the rules like universal instantiation, modus ponens, and modus tollens. In an inference of this kind, one of the premises is a universally general statement, which is the analog of the statement of universal concomitance, Vyapti, in the inference for others, Pararth Anumana. Charvaka criticism pertains to this type of inference. It is the criticism of a specific type of deductive inference, which is based on inductive generalization. Now, on the basis of these clarifications, we can try to appreciate Charvaka criticism of inference. Philosophically, Charvaka criticism of inference can be divided into two parts. One can be called dilemma of inference. Charvakas raise a dilemma which renders inference as problematic. And B, arguments against universal concomitance. Charvakas point out how universal concomitance, which is the basis of any inference, that is anuman, cannot be ascertained. Though the above two parts are interconnected, each one of them has a distinct conceptual pattern. Hence, it is elegant and also convenient to discuss them separately. That is, these two points of criticism, dilemma of inference and arguments against the universal concomitance, they are interconnected. Dilemma of inference in its elaboration will include arguments against universal concomitance also, but it is convenient to discuss them separately. Dilemma of inference, Jayanta Bhatta's version in Nyayamanjari. So Jayanta Bhatta in Nyayamanjari refers to the criticism of inference as given by Charvakas, and one of the verses gives what is called dilemma of inference. Where is the case for inference? Because in the case of particular, that is vishesha, there is no connection. In the case of universal, that is samanya, there is redundancy, that is proving the proved, siddha sadhana. And a particular qualified by universal is not tenable. That is, visheshe anugama bhavat samanye siddha sadhanat tadvato nupapannatvat anumana katha kutaha. That is the verse. This version can be understood as a trilemma which raises three alternatives regarding the object of inference. The question raised here is whether the object of inference is a particular or a universal, or a particular characterized by a universal. That is, what is the nature of sadhya? Is it a vishesha or samanya, or samanya vishishta vishesha, vishesha characterized by samanya? Charvakas point out that every alternative is riddled with some difficulty. This can be explained with reference to inference of fire from smoke. If what we want to infer is a particular fire item, that is vishesha, say the fire on the hill, then the problem is that it has no connection with the other fire items. For example, the one in the kitchen, on the basis of which we arrive at the knowledge of the former from that of the latter. So every fire item, as it were, is independent or separate, and there is no anugama between one particular and another particular, no anvaya, no continuity. Now, suppose somebody says that it is not a particular fire item, but a universal fire, that is fire in general or fireness that we are inferring. But then the so-called fire in general is already established. Hence, it is redundant to prove it again. So if somebody says that what we infer is not a particular fire, but fire in general, then Charvaka objection is that it is already proved. So it is a case of siddha sadhana. At this stage, the opponent may come out with a third alternative, that what we prove is not just a particular fire item, nor universal fire, but a particular fire item as characterized by the universal fireness. That is vannitva vishishta vanni on the mountain. On this, Charvakas are saying that in the particular characterized by universal is untenable, because there is no real thing called universal fire. So just as Buddhists criticize existence of samanyas, such as ghatatva, patatva, vannitva, and so on and so forth, similarly, Charvakas also criticize the existence of samanyas. One of the three alternatives and the three corresponding objections raised by the Charvakas, the first one is most important. The opponents of Charvakas believe in the pramanahood of inference, because they believe that the discrete cases of smoke and fire, whether on the hill or in the kitchen, are well connected by the relation called invariable concomitance or pervasion, that is avinabhava or vyapti. These relations not only exist, but they also can be known and ascertained by us. The extreme empiricist Charvakas are raising doubts about the availability and knowability of such connections. So we come to the second part, that is Charvaka's arguments against universal concomitance. With the development of the theory of inference, universal concomitance or vyapti between reason property and target property, these are the words used for hetu and sadhya, was accepted as the ground for inferential knowledge by all the systems which accepted inference as pramana. As against this, Charvakas argued that universal concomitance cannot be ascertained. The Charvaka's argument can be formulated in two stages. First stage, there probably are no laws of nature at all. And second stage, even if there are laws of nature, they cannot be known for certain. So stage one, there are no laws of nature. Those who accept inference as pramana presume that there is absolute regularity in nature. The idea behind this is that all things in this world have their own nature or essence, swabhava. They function and interact with each other according to their essential nature of things. This is a minimalistic causal explanation of the world, which Charvaka is denying here. Here they are pointing out that the so-called capacities of things or essences of things, swabhavas of things, change with the change in space, time and states of things. This seems to be the position of what is called accidentalist camp of Charvakas, Yadruchhavadin Charvakas, who would question the belief in the uniformity of nature. This is the initial position presented as a provisional position. At this stage, the Charvakas, now we come to the second stage, even if there are laws of nature, we cannot know them for certain. At this stage, the Charvakas accept for the sake of argument that there are laws of nature. The question that they now raise is that whether one can know any such law for certain. A law of nature would generally assume the form of an invariable or necessary relation between two types of things, events, such that if alpha type of thing or event occurs, beta type of thing or event must occur or must have occurred in past or will occur in future as the nature of the relation may be. Such a relation is said to hold, for example, between smoke and fire. All Indian philosophical systems except Charvaka Darshana believe that such a relation holds between smoke and fire and that it can be known for certain. Systems differ in their explanation of the exact nature of this relation and the way the relation is known. For Buddhism, it is essentially a causal relation or the relation of identity if it is between two aspects of one and the same thing. That is, if the vyapti relation holds between two different entities, then it has to be causal relation. If it holds between two aspects of one and the same thing, then it will be some kind of identity relation or tadatmya relation. For other systems, the relation of invariable concomitance need not be restricted to causal relation and identity relation. However, they try to explain the invariable concomitance relation in some other ways. Hence, different conceptions of pervasion were presented by Nayayikas as non-deviant relation, that is avyabhicharita sambandha, or swabhavika sambandha, natural relation, unconditioned relation, nirupadhika sambandha, or relation of having common locus, samanadhikaranya. Similarly, different systems suggested different ways of ascertaining the relation. In fact, this was a problem before these systems of philosophy. Although these systems accepted inference as a pramana, there was no provision in the pramana systems to incorporate the knowledge of universal concomitance. Hence, the question was that of adjusting this type of knowledge within the available pramana system or to amend it. Hence, different systems came out with different proposals. Purva Mimamsa held that Vyapti can be known through ordinary perception, but that ordinary perception has to be repeated perception, Bhuyo Darshana. According to Nyaya, it is through some kind of extraordinary perception, that is Alaukika Pratyaksha, that we can know universal truths. Again, within Nyaya, Jayanta Bhatta held that through some kind of intuition or mental perception, we can know universal Vyapti relation. In Jainism, an independent Pramana called Tarka is accepted for the knowledge of Vyapti that we have already seen. In Buddhism, determination of Vyapti is made through on the basis of necessity, and that is called Avinabhava Niyama. Now let us briefly consider the actual and possible responses to these proposals. So how would Charvaka respond to these proposals? According to this view, that is ordinary perception, that is repeated perception, Bhuyo Darshana, one can ascertain invariable concomitance relation between smoke and fire because one has perceived smoke with fire several times but has not seen smoke without fire. This view is held by Mimamsakas and Nayayikas with some variation. As against this, the Charvakas point out that even if one observes smoke 100 times with fire and never sees smoke without fire, one cannot rule out the possibility that smoke may exist without fire. By repeated observation, one at the most gets a high probability of smoke existing with fire, but no necessity in it. For knowing fire for certain on the basis of smoke, what one needs is the ascertainment of a necessary relation between them, but that is not possible. This is the gist of Charvaka skepticism about the knowledge of universal concomitance. It highlights the basic limitations of human knowledge concerning the laws of nature. The second alternative was extraordinary perception, Alaukika Pratyaksha. The problem with the proposal of repeated observation and non-observation of deviation, that is Vyabhichara Adarshana, Sahachara Darshana, and Vyabhichara Adarshana. The problem with this is that, after all, observation can give us particular cases of the coexistence of reason property and target property. It cannot give us the knowledge of all cases of coexistence. To make room for the knowledge of universal truths, Nayayikas introduced a kind of extraordinary perception which gives the knowledge of all smokes through the universal smokeness residing in a single smoke. So for them, a smoke possesses smokeness, which is a universal characteristic, because smokeness is shared by all smokes in the universe, whether past, present and future. So through the knowledge of one smoke, one can know smokeness which resides in it. And since smokeness is shared by all smokes, through one smokeness, he can have some kind of insight into the nature of all smokes insofar as they have smokeness. In this way, Nayayikas tried to make a room for perceptual knowledge of all smokes and all fires, in order that the knowledge of the universal truth, wherever there is smoke, there is fire, becomes possible. It can be doubted, however, whether a satisfactory explanation of the knowledge of universal concomitance can be given by taking recourse to extraordinary perception of the above kind. By universal-based extraordinary perception, if at all it makes sense to say that it is a kind of genuine veridical perception, one can perhaps know all smokes and all fires, all smokes as smoke, all fires as fire. But one will not know whether all these smokes are accompanied or preceded by fire. Similarly, one will not know that there is a necessary relation between smoke and fire, such that smoke cannot exist without fire. And unless one knows these things, one cannot be said to have knowledge of the, one cannot be said to have known the invariable relation between smoke and fire. Now we come to the next alternative, that is intuition or mental perception, manasa pratyaksha, as a means to the knowledge of vyapti. The Nyaya logicians like Jayanta Bhatta regarded mental perception, manasa pratyaksha, as the means to the ascertainment of universal concomitants. It has to face a similar problem as the proposal of extraordinary perception. The so-called intuitive grasp of mental or mental perception of universal concomitants will not have necessity and objectivity that one expects from pramana. Then taraka, that is an independent pramana which was accepted by Jainas. We have seen in the last talk, it should be, that Jainas suggested that generalization, that is tarka, should be accepted as an independent pramana through which we know general truths such as the relation of universal concomitants. The contribution of Jainas to the debate on the knowledge of universal pervasion lies in their realization that the knowledge of pervasion cannot be subsumed under the traditionally accepted framework of pramanas. And if at all universal pervasion is knowable through a pramana, then a different pramana will have to be accepted for that. Here the question is, given that in smoke fire case, one has observed smoke only with fire and never without fire, how does tarka, which is an independent pramana, lead one to the universal and necessary statement that wherever there is smoke, there must be fire? Jainas do not give any explanation of this. They only point out that some independent pramana is required for the explanation of the knowledge of vyapti, and they say that tarka can be such a pramana. But how, on the basis of tarka, the knowledge of vyapti is possible, we don't find any explanation of that. Jainas do not give any explanation of this, hence the logical status of tarka as pramana remains unclear. Now, determination through necessity, avinabhava niyama, which is the Buddhist proposal. We have seen in the third lecture that according to Dharmakirti, the law of invariable relation is mentally constructed by us on the basis of necessity in the form of causation or identity. Though this mental construction is the basis of anumana pramana, Dharmakirti does not give it the status of pramana. The question here, because for him, the knowledge of universals has to be of the nature of vikalpa, mental construction. And it cannot be perception, because perception is without any mental construction. It cannot be inference also, because if this knowledge of universal truth is regarded as inference, then there will be the problem of circularity and infinite regress, because knowledge of vyapti is a necessary prerequisite of inference. So vyapti jnana itself cannot be regarded as a kind of inference. So he regards it as a kind of vikalpa only. The question here is that even if we grant that the universal concomitants can be cognized only on the basis of identity or causation, how is causal relation ascertained? Can Buddhists really get rid of observation and non-observation while explaining the ascertainment of universal relation based on causality? Because this was one of the main arguments of Dharmakirti, that it is not on the basis of observation and non-observation that we can know avinabhava niyama, but either on the basis of tadatmya or tadutpatti. To ascertain the relation of causal necessity between two objects, the Buddhists apply a test consisting of five steps. One, non-perception of an effect prior to its production. Two, perception of the cause. Three, the appearance of the effect in immediate succession. Four, disappearance of the cause. And five, disappearance of the effect in immediate succession. So suppose we are just observing that there is fire and smoke is coming out of it. So it is on the basis of observation and non-observation that we decide that it is not just the case of something occurring after something, but it is also the case of causal relation. So how do we decide that? They say that it is on the basis of these five perceptions and non-perceptions. This is, after all, the method of observation and non-observation. And it pertains to arising of a particular effect from a particular cause. Particular effect from a particular cause. So the question remains how one can arrive at a statement of universal causal relation on the basis of observation of a particular case. So far what I have tried to show is that from Charvaka point of view, all the explanations of the knowledge of Vyapti are not unacceptable. Now I am just comparing Charvaka with Hume. Hence, different proposals of explaining the knowledge of universal concomitants rest on the method of repeated observation of reason property and target property together, and non-observation of reason property without target property. Against this, the Charvakas have rightly pointed out that even if one observes smoke 100 times with fire and never sees smoke without fire, one cannot rule out the possibility that smoke may exist without fire. The Charvaka skepticism about the knowledge of universal concomitants closely resembles David Hume's skepticism about induction. Hume's theory of induction has two aspects, negative and positive. The problem of induction constitutes the negative aspect of his theory. The positive element in Hume's theory was his introduction of the notion of probability, which acquired importance in due course as a part of scientific method. The germs of the theory of probability are also found in the Charvaka criticism of inference. Now, I come to some concluding remarks. A difficulty in the extreme empiricist epistemology of Charvakas. It can be argued that the extreme empiricist epistemology of Charvakas, if extended to its logical end, leads to phenomenalism and not to materialism. In fact, the position of extreme empiricist Charvakas leads to a dilemma. The idea is that, now what is phenomenalism? Suppose I am perceiving a table, then a question can be asked, what am I really perceiving? Then a phenomenalist will say that I am just perceiving a color, a shape, and later on I may go there and I may also experience a kind of hard touch. But beyond that, I am not able to experience the thing called table, the so-called thing in itself called table. Whereas a materialist would say that when I perceive a table, I really perceive the thing called table, which is a material object. Now, Charvakas are claiming that, when Charvakas talk about perception as means to knowledge, generally they would say that through perception, what we know four Mahabhutas. At least three Mahabhutas we can know by either visual perception or through touch, and Vayu also we may know through touch, for example. But what we really know are the things, material objects. So that is why it will be a kind of materialism rather than phenomenalism. But if we, consider their extreme empiricist position seriously, then I am suggesting that it will lead to a kind of phenomenalism and not to materialism. In fact, the position of extreme empiricist Charvakas leads to a dilemma. If perception alone is accepted as pramana, then the statements regarding God, other worlds, etc. can be rejected. But the materialistic thesis will also have to be rejected. And what is materialistic thesis? That consciousness arises from four Mahabhutas. So, if perception alone is regarded as pramana, then that thesis also will have to be rejected, because it is a thesis about inference. If on the other hand, perception according to which perception along with inference is accepted as pramana, then the materialistic thesis can be defended. But the arguments for metaphysical entities such as God and soul will also have to be accepted. This reminds one of a similar dilemma the logical empiricists in the West faced as a result of the verifiability theory of meaning. Weak verificationism leads to acceptance of scientific propositions as meaningful, but also to the acceptance of some metaphysical statements as meaningful, which is not desirable. And strong verificationism helps in discarding metaphysical statements as meaningless, but it also makes us discard some scientific propositions involving theoretical terms as meaningless, which is not desirable. So, towards mitigated empiricism. This underlies the need for a more accommodative and yet stronger epistemology, which will preserve its negative or destructive elements with regard to transcendental metaphysical claims, but will be more constructive with respect to this worldly approach to reality and values. Such an epistemology assumes two forms. One is verificationist epistemology of more learned, that is Sushikshita Taracharvakas, as referred to by Jayanta Bhatta, and common sense epistemology of Purandara, as mentioned by Kamala Sheela in Tattva Sangraha Panjika. This brings us to what can be called the position of a mitigated empiricist Charvaka. This we will discuss in the next lecture. Thank you.
Namaste, sir. Myself, Dr. Deshpande. First of all, we are very thankful to you for such a great class. To what extent Charvaka philosophy can be compared with logical positivist school in Western sciences?
So, logical positivists held basically that only empirically verifiable sentences are to be regarded as cognitively meaningful, and which are not empirically verifiable, they are not meaningful at all. So this was the position, and this is close to what I have we will discuss as positivist Charvaka, according to which perception is pramana, and also that anumana is pramana which is empirically verifiable, that is the result of which can be verified on the basis of perception. If it cannot be verified, then it is not pramana. The difference, of course, will be that they are not talking about meaningfulness or meaninglessness, but they are talking about truth and falsehood. Charvakas are talking about truth and falsehood. So the statements about metaphysics, for example, logical positivists, they will discard them as meaningless statements, nonsense, some kind of meaningless statements, whereas Charvakas may not say that they are meaningless statements, they would only say that they cannot be proved to be true, because on the basis of pratyaksha and empirically verifiable inference, they cannot be proved. So this will be the position of what we will discuss, that is, Utpanna Pratiti Anumana is acceptable, Utpadya Pratiti Anumana is not acceptable, according to Sushikshita Tara Charvakas of Jayanta Bhatta. Jayanta Bhatta talks about such Charvakas, whereas here we are talking about extreme empiricist Charvakas who are accepting only perception as pramana and inference as not pramana at all.
Good afternoon, I'm Dr. Girish Dede. How is the Charvaka philosophy close and different than existentialism?
Of course, I don't have good knowledge of existentialism, but existentialism, as far as I understand, is more concerned with life and not just, the material, authentic life, how to lead authentic life. And there the question is more about regarding oneself as the authority, rather than believing in others, which will be a kind of false dogmatic way of living. So insofar as opposition to dogmatic, belief in dogmatic views, they will come close. But their concern for life and different experiences in life, we don't find them in Charvaka.
Thank you.
Yes.
स्पेसिफिक अध्यायाच्या बद्दलचा नाही हा प्रश्न, पण एकंदरीतच आपलं जे डिस्कशन झालंय आतापर्यंत त्याच्यावर की आपल्याकडे एक व्ह्यू आहे ज्ञानाबद्दलचा, तो मला विचारायचा होता. हाऊ इट रिलेट्स ज्ञान म्हणजे अल्टिमेट ज्ञान म्हणजे आपल्या याच्यात ज्ञानाची त्रिपुटी समजली जाते, ज्ञेय, ज्ञान आणि ज्ञाता. हे तिघं एकत्र झाले की दॅट इज द एंड ऑफ नॉलेज असा एक, विशेषतः ज्ञानेश्वर आणि हे जे प्रत्यभिज्ञ हे आहे तत्वज्ञान, त्याच्यामध्ये हा एक व्ह्यू मांडलेला आहे. तर हा कुठे बसतो या सगळ्या आपल्या ह्याच्यामध्ये?
थोडंसं त्याच्यात सुधारणा अशी सुचवेन की त्रिपुटीयुक्त ज्ञान हे अंतिम मानलेलं नाही या अध्यात्मवाद्यांनी. सर्वसाधारणपणे त्यांचं म्हणणं असं की आपण आपल्याला जे काही ज्ञान होतं ते त्रिपुटीयुक्त असतं, त्याच्यामध्ये ज्ञाता, ज्ञेय आणि ज्ञान हे त्रिपुटी अस्तित्वात असतेच, पण जे काही शुद्ध ज्ञान आहे ते त्रिपुटीरहित आहे. त्यामध्ये ते नुसतंच ज्ञान आहे, ते तिथे ज्ञात्याचं ज्ञातेपण हे लोप पावतं आणि ज्ञेय नावाचं काही शिल्लक राहत नाही, ज्ञानाचा विषय म्हणून काही भासतच नाही, अशा प्रकारचं काहीतरी ज्ञान आहे. आणि अर्थात असं सगळेजणं मानतील असं नाही, पण अद्वैत वेदांती असं मानतील की ब्रह्मज्ञान हे त्रिपुटीरहित असतं. अगदी जैनसुद्धा ती शक्यता म्हणून स्वीकारतील. बौद्धांमध्ये त्रिपुटीरहित ज्ञानाची शक्यता स्वीकारलेली आहे. पण सर्वसाधारणपणे आता नैयायिक ठामपणे असं म्हणतील की कुठलंही ज्ञान हे त्रिपुटीयुक्तच असतं, त्रिपुटीरहित ज्ञान असू शकत नाही असं नैयायिकांचं म्हणणं आहे. बौद्धांमध्ये सुद्धा जे आता साकार विज्ञानवाद आणि निराकार विज्ञानवाद असा जो एक वाद आहे की प्रत्येक ज्ञानाला काहीतरी आकार असतोच असं साकार विज्ञानवादी मानतात. आकार असतो म्हणजे तो अर्थात कुठला आकार असतो? ज्ञानानेच घेतलेला विषयाचा आकार असतो आणि ज्ञानानेच घेतलेल्या ज्ञात्याचा आकार असतो. तर जी काही त्रिपुटी असते ती त्या ज्ञानातूनच निर्माण होते, पण ती सतत निर्माण होतेच असं साकार विज्ञानवादी मानतील. निराकार विज्ञानवादी असं मानतात की मुळात ज्ञान हे निराकार आहे, आकार आपण ज्याला समजतो ती काहीतरी बाह्य आरोपित गोष्ट आहे, ती खरी नाही. त्यामुळे बौद्ध तत्वज्ञानात अशा दोन्ही शक्यता उपलब्ध होतात की शुद्ध ज्ञान त्रिपुटीरहित ज्ञान असू शकेल, कारण त्रिपुटी ही सुद्धा काहीतरी एक चुकीची आहे, आरोपित आहे, असं वसुबंधूनी उदाहरणार्थ त्याच्या विज्ञप्ती मात्रता सिद्धीमध्ये असा दावा केला आहे की त्रिपुटीयुक्त ज्ञान हे चुकीचं ज्ञान आहे, कारण ती त्रिपुटी ही एक प्रकारची भ्रांत कल्पित अशी त्रिपुटी असते, मुळात ती अस्तित्वात नाही. तर हे म्हणजे त्रिपुटीच्या पलीकडे गेलं पाहिजे असं मानणारे अनेक जण आहेत. आणि असं शुद्ध ज्ञान काहीतरी असू शकतं की जिथे विषय नाही आणि ज्ञाताही नाही पण नुसती जाणीव आहे, ही एक शक्यता आपल्याकडे अनेकांनी मांडलेली आहे. तशी शक्यता ही म्हणजे पाश्चात्य तत्वज्ञानात आपल्याला सहसा आढळत नाही की ज्ञान हे इंटेन्शनॅलिटी म्हणजे ज्ञान हे नेहमी कशाचं तरी ज्ञान असतं, कुठल्या तरी विषयाचं ज्ञान असतं. विषयरहित ज्ञान अशी काहीतरी गोष्ट आहे हे मानण्याकडे कल दिसत नाही. प्युअर कॉन्शियसनेस वगैरे वगैरे ज्याला म्हटलं जातं.
कॉन्शियसनेसला
मानतच नाही मानतो ना. अच्छा, कॉन्शियसनेसला मानत नाही असं नाही, तर कॉन्शियसनेसचा आता जो काही कॉन्शियसनेस आहे हा कुठून आला हा जो प्रश्न आहे त्याच्यावर इतर सगळेजण असं म्हणतात. काही जण असं म्हणतील की तो कॉन्शियसनेस हा कुठला तरी आत्मा म्हणा जीव म्हणा असा कुठला तरी एक आपल्यामध्ये आहे, त्याचा तो गुणधर्म तरी आहे असं मानलं जाईल, किंवा त्याचा तो स्वभावच आहे एसेन्स आहे असं मानलं जाईल. तो कुठल्या तरी द्रव्याचा एसेन्स आहे आणि ते द्रव्य म्हणजे आत्मा किंवा जीव किंवा पुरुष तत्व असं तरी मानलं जाईल, किंवा जे आत्मा मानत नाहीत म्हणजे बौद्ध ते म्हणतील की कॉन्शियसनेस ही एक जशी आपल्यामध्ये मॅटर एक क्षणोक्षणी उत्पन्न होतं नाहीसं होतं त्याच्याचबरोबर कॉन्शियसनेससुद्धा उत्पन्न होतं नाहीसा होतो. त्या कॉन्शियसनेसला कोणीही आत्मा नावाचं काही द्रव्य हा आधारभूत आहे असं नाही, पण ते मॅटर बरोबर मॅटरशी इंटरॅक्शन करत ते उत्पन्न होतं नष्ट होतं उत्पन्न होतं नष्ट होतं. आता मेल्यानंतर काय होतं तर ती कॉन्शियसनेस सेरीज जी असते त्याच्याबरोबर संस्कार हे येत असल्यामुळे त्या जन्मात केलेले त्याच्यापूर्वीचे त्या संस्कारांमुळे पुन्हा पुन्हा कॉन्शियसनेस निर्माण होणं ती सेरीज चालू राहणं हे अटळ राहतं आपल्या बाबतीत सामान्य माणसांच्या बाबतीमध्ये की ज्याच्यामुळे पुनर्जन्म होतो पुन्हा दुसऱ्या देहाशी तो कॉन्शियसनेस सेरीज ती जोडली जाते आणि ती चालू राहते. चार्वाक हे असं मानतात की कॉन्शियसनेस नावाची गोष्ट आहे ती देहाच्या आश्रयाने राहते, ती देहाशिवाय राहू शकत नाही आणि त्याच्यामुळे ज्या वेळेला देह नष्ट होतो माणूस मरतो त्यावेळेला कॉन्शियसनेस नेरीज संपते. त्यामुळे पूर्वकर्मांमुळे ती चालू राहिली पाहिजे राहील हे ते मान्य करत नाहीत. पूर्वकर्म म्हणजे अगदी ह्या जन्मातल्या कर्मांमुळे सुद्धा कॉन्शियसनेस सेरीज ही मरणानंतरही चालू राहिली पाहिजे हे ते मान्य करत नाहीत. पण कॉन्शियसनेसच ते नाकारतात असं नाही. साधारणपणे परदेशामध्ये जे युरोपियन फिलॉसॉफीमध्ये जे काही आहे की मटेरियलिझम याचा एक अर्थ असा घेतला जातो की फक्त मॅटर एक्झिस्ट कॉन्शियसनेस डज नॉट एक्झिस्ट, याला आपण रिडक्टिव्ह मटेरियलिझम असं म्हणू शकतो, एलिमिनेटिव्ह मटेरियलिझम. हा म्हणजे बरेचसे सायंटिस्ट असं म्हणतील की केवळ ब्रेन प्रोसेसेस आहेत त्याच्या पलीकडे कॉन्शियसनेस नावाची गोष्ट नाहीच असं ते मानतील. पण काही जण असं मानणारे आहेत की ओव्हर अँड अबाव ब्रेन प्रोसेसेस देर इज कॉन्शियसनेस विच इज नॉट रिड्युसिबल टू ब्रेन प्रोसेसेस बट विच इज डिपेंडंट ऑन ब्रेन प्रोसेसेस, इट डज नॉट एक्झिस्ट इंडिपेंडंटली ऑफ ब्रेन प्रोसेसेस. त्याच्यामुळे ब्रेन प्रोसेसेस जशा असतात तशा त्याच्याशी समांतर म्हणा किंवा त्याच्यातूनच उत्पन्न होणाऱ्या कॉन्शियसनेसच्या सुद्धा प्रोसेसेस असतात, कॉन्शियस प्रोसेसेस पण असतात, त्याला एपिफेनॉमिनॉलिझम असं म्हणतात. तर असा एक असा मानणारे सुद्धा विज्ञानाचे तत्वज्ञ आहेत असं म्हणू आपण, वैज्ञानिक आहेत की मला माहिती नाही, पण सर्ल हा जो आहे तो अशा प्रकारचा मानला जातो की तो नॉन रिडक्टिव्ह मटेरियलिस्ट आहे. तर चार्वाक हे नॉन रिडक्टिव्ह मटेरियलिस्ट या सदरात मोडतील की कॉन्शियसनेस आहे पण तो ह्याच्यावर अवलंबून आहे शरीरावर अवलंबून. आता ते ब्रेन नावाची गोष्ट चार्वाकांना माहीत नव्हती त्याच्यामुळे ते देहातिरिक्त चैतन्य नावाची काही गोष्ट नाही.
Thank you so much.